We will not look at this in detail, but for completeness, I want to briefly talk about optimizing multiple queries. So the idea is you have like a workload of queries and they all came into the database system at once, or let's say briefly after the other. In this case, we have two queries. Here we have a join between R and T, a natural join, and then we join S on this result. And then here for the second query, we have R natural join U, and then we join with S. The idea behind optimization of multiple queries is to see commonalities between the queries in order to make the joint execution more efficient. So in the simplest case, we have two queries that are accessing one relation. And instead of reading the relation from disk twice, we can share the scan and both queries can benefit from the reading of the tuples. So in this situation, which commonalities do we see here? Well, we see, first of all, there is relation R used in both queries. There is T and U and S and S. So T and U are obviously not the same, but S and S are the same. So S and R are read in both queries. Now, the good thing is, since we know that the join operator is commutative and associative, we see that we're actually computing the join between R and S twice. Right. So if we now want to do the query optimization, we can compute the join only once and rewrite both queries such that they can make use of this pre-computed join. When we're doing this, we see we have now R join S and R join S. So this needs to be executed only once. And then for the first query, we take the result and join it with T. And for the second query, we take the result and join it with U. Now this looks quite good and very obvious that this kind of makes sense, but it's not always the case that this is beneficial. For instance, what happens if the join R and S is super expensive? Because both relations are very big and perhaps the selectivity is also very large. So many tuples will qualify. So this is not a good strategy to execute this query and not a good strategy to execute this query. Okay, we can reuse the result, but overall this might overshadow the benefit of doing this. A possible strategy that you see often is to optimize the queries individually. So in this situation here, you would not find this join because it's expensive, if we assume, but you're optimizing query 1 and 2 separately, and afterwards you're searching for commonalities. So you would not reorder these individual queries to find commonalities, but you're optimizing them once individually, and then afterwards you're finding commonalities if they exist. And I have already mentioned this, the simplest possibility that we have seen here is the observation that we have relations that we need in both queries, like R and S in this case, so then we can benefit already from so-called shared scans. So we have to read the relation only once and not multiple times. Another important topic to optimize the performance of database systems are materialized views. So views we have already seen in the undergraduate course. So you can write in SQL create view and give a name to this view, and you give a query basically that is representing this view. And this view does not really exist, so there's no table that is storing the contents of the view. The view is only like a definition of a query that you gave a name, and now it can make it easier to work with a database if you have some separate views instead of only the raw tables underlying. Important observation is that the view is not materialized. So every time you're accessing the view, you have to pay the cost for the evaluation of the query that is underlying this view. In contrast to this, we have materialized views. Here, the view is pre-computed, that means the query underlying the view is executed and the results are physically stored. Now the benefit is that if you want to access the view, you don't have to execute the query, but you can right away go and read the tuples. So this might be a good plan now to create very many materialized views, but then there's also the cost to pay, because if you have a view which is materialized, so the results are stored, then you have to also keep it up to date. So again, so if you say create view and you give it a name, and then you have the view definition, this query here is executed in the first case for the normal views that we know every time you're accessing the view X. And here in the second case for the materialized view, this query here is executed only once, and the table is stored in the database system. Now, of course, here you have select and so on from where, and if the underlying tables change, let's say R is changed, then you have to reflect this change in your materialized view. And that's, of course, costly to do. But let's assume we have some of these views materialized. And then it's, of course, important that we also make good use of them. Let's say we have a materialized view that was created using the following query. We're selecting a set of attributes from a set of tables and apply a predicate CV. Obviously, the V here stands for view. And now there's a query coming into the system. It looks like this. The query selects certain attributes from a certain number of relations and is applying some predicate CQ. Now the question is it possible, or under which circumstances, is it possible to rewrite this query such that it is using the view? And this is done here on the slide, described when this is actually possible. So this is possible if you're looking at the attributes here, LV, these are the ones we select. Then that means when we're using the view later on here, we can only make use of the attributes that we are selecting in the view. If the predicate here is kicking out tuples that we would require here in the query, then we cannot make use of the view. Okay, so when can we use the view? All relations that are appearing here in the view definition have to also appear in the query. There can be more relations appearing here. There can be Rx and Ry and so on additionally, but the ones here need to be among them. In the naive case, these are identical. And that's of course fine. In this case, we can just replace here the RQ set with a view, because yeah, they are identical anyway, appear here. What else? What about the where clause predicate? So we see we have here predicate CV. Now, if these two are equal, CV and CQ, we can eliminate the where clause entirely, because this check done by the predicate CV is already inside the tuples, or checked for the tuples inside the materialized view. If it's not the same, and let's say that CQ is equivalent to this and some additional predicate, then we can use the materialized view, but we still have to keep here the check for the predicate C, because only a part of CQ has been checked already in the view. The attributes are quite simple. The attributes that we want to return here have to also be, of course, selected by the view. You see here that we specifically look for the AND predicate, so the conjunction, as I said earlier, because if you're using a view here, instead, let's say, of the entire list RQ, because of the definition of V our view, all the tuples are guaranteed to qualify the predicate CV. So, and if it's identical to CQ, we don't have to check anything. But if there is more going on in CQ, we have to take what is new in CQ compared to CV and still check this part. For OR, this is not possible. Right? So if you have OR here, that means that you want to select from this set of relations tuples that fulfilling CV. Well, you get these from the view, okay? Or C, and this you don't get from the view, so you cannot make use of the view. And in exercises and also in exams, you often ask the question, is it possible to use the view? And if so, please rewrite the query that it is using this materialized view. Rewrite means that we would eliminate, let's say, RQ here, and replace it by the view, and if necessary, we have to mention some more relations here, as we have already discussed for the CQ part. And here it's basically just written what I said earlier. So in case the requirements are fulfilled of the previous slide, we can replace we can use the view in the query definition. It's just exactly what I have already mentioned on the previous slide. Remember the discussion on index selection or index tuning in a database? We had like a list of criteria that would guide us a little bit which indices we have to create or we should create. And now we have a similar situation because we can of course create all kind of materialized views. Like every query that comes into the system could be potentially a materialized view, and then we say, okay, let's materialize it, and whenever the query comes again, we have already pre-computed the results. Well, that's, of course, like a brute force approach, will not really work very well because it's unlikely, well, depending on the application, of course, but it's unlikely that you see all the queries again. So then you're wasting too much space to materialize the views. And additionally, you have to also keep them up to date. So you have to make the decision wisely which of the views you're actually materializing. And like for the index creation, we have some guidelines. And they are not so evolved like for the index creation guidelines. But here you see, obviously, you have to look at the from clause of the queries in order to derive which of the subsets of this from clauses you would like to take as a view and then materializing it. And for the where clauses, you also have to look which predicates you see in the queries and to find a subset of these, looking for conjunctive predicates in order to create a view that is doing already the check of a part of the predicate, and the queries after rewriting have to check the additional predicate that was not yet checked by the view, as just discussed on the previous slides. Right? Attributes, of course, it's also easy to see if a query wants to have access to a certain number of attributes from the relation, you have to provide these attributes. It means that the view has to return these as well. Now, a few more words on updates. The problem with materialized views is that they are materialized. Well, the benefit of materialized views is that they are materialized. It's always a trade-off between materializing too many things or not enough, because there's a cost involved, not only storage cost, but also maintenance cost. It's pretty much the same as for index structures. You can think of creating many indices, but then you also have to pay the price for it to maintain them and hope that the ones you created are sufficient to be quite useful for your database workload without causing too many trouble for the maintenance. There's the concept of incremental maintenance, because if you consider having a relation R and S, and you have, let's say, created a join between these two and materialized the join, and there's now an update coming and you're adding one more tuple here, it's somehow obvious that you will not create in a brute force way again the join. Why wouldn't you need to do that? Because, well, you have already joined this tuple and this tuple, or you have tested this these two if they are joining, and these and so on. You don't have to do it again. Which part do you have to do again, or which part do you did not do yet? Well, it's this new tuple that was inserted to R. This needs to be checked with all tuples of S. So, more formally, we have a few, which is the join between R and S. If you're changing R, in this case here, we see what I have illustrated already, the case of an insert, and there's a tuple IR, which is inserted to the old version of R, that we call rOld, then the new view is the old view with the union of those tuples of S that join with IR. Right, so this is IR, and this is S. So what comes in addition to the old view is only this tuple joined with all of the tuples of S. And such rules can be expressed also for different operations, like delete or update, and it works similarly. You have to consider what is the change done by the updated relation, or both relations can also be updated, to the view, and how can you express the updated view, which is called vNew here, based on the old view, and the minimum amount of work to update it.